Lord Ahmad, pleasure to have you with us. And straight away, we'll just go straight to, you were just a part of the NDPRAC meeting. And I could recall earlier that the governor said that he was basically uncomfortable with the not preparation fully prepared for the Atlantic hurricane season, which incidentally got underway today officially. In terms of support, taking into consideration all that happened during Hurricanes Irma and Maria and the devastation, how is the UK government assisting in helping Montserrat, as well as the other overseas territories by extension, to build resilience to such eventualities, severe weather systems?
Well, thank you for that, and you're quite right. I've just, together with both the Premier and the Governor, attended the meeting where we were discussing the preparedness for the hurricane seasons. It's not lost on me, it's that I'm here on the bang on the start of the hurricane season. But it is exactly that that brought me here, was to ensure that across the independent Caribbean, as well as the overseas territories, what lessons have been learned, what has been put into place, and what more needs to be done to ensure that we are prepared to mitigate as best as possible the risk of hurricanes and indeed the response to such. In this regard, let me reassure your listeners, indeed viewers and readers, that the UK government, first of all, stands very firmly with all our overseas territories. They are part of the British family, and that's how we see them. And in that regard, we already have deployed RFA Mounts Bay, which was instrumental in the immediate response to the hurricanes, particularly in Anguilla and the British Virgin Islands. And indeed, that is provided and stocked with appropriate means to ensure the immediate response can be met. An important part of that is coordination with local partners, and RFA Mounts Bay yesterday also conducted an exercise with the Cayman Islands. And that's an important element on what the UK has been doing subsequent to the last hurricane seasons, because it's not just about seeing what the response is here locally, and I'm sure the Premier and the Governor will wish to speak to that as well, but it's also what is the regional response and what's the international response. And in that regard, we are working very closely with international strategic partners. That includes the Canadians, the Americans, the Dutch, who have territories in the Caribbean, as well as the French, and also key partners within the region. So SEDIMA are part of that discussion and response, as well as Jamaica and indeed the Cayman Islands. And the next key assessment of that is everyone will be meeting in London towards the end of June, just to ensure that all the plans are in place. Now, the simple, I could go into the details of every element of it, but the simple element, which is to be understood, is all the countries I've named within the region have interests. They also have assets. Our job is to ensure those assets can be fully aligned and the response can be met in the most effective and efficient manner. And certainly the United Kingdom's been working very hard on ensuring that response is also the kind of response people expect. The other thing is we've been working with each territory on their national plans, as well as we've done here in Montserrat as well, to ensure where there are gaps, those gaps can be filled. If there are immediate requirements, those requirements can be met. And in terms of medium-term planning as well, as you would have seen, it's about enabling the territories themselves to build resilience. So some of the projects that we've seen across the piece on improving telecommunications, for example, is also a key element of ensuring that the response people get is one that is reflective of the urgency that we all need to see when such events occur.
I know we're zeroing in on acute weather systems or severe weather systems, hurricanes, tropical storms, but Montserrat is exposed to a number of hazards. And when we look at Montserrat's situation 20 plus years after the volcanic situation, we are in a situation, unique situation, in fact. And in terms of the assistance that Montserrat requires, I'm looking along that line in terms of building resilience here in Montserrat.
Well, I mean, one of the projects in terms of the fiber optic cable, for example, the project we're currently working on with Montserrat on that will help resilience in terms of communications. And the medium-term perspectives also is to ensure that we provide support in terms of access abilities as well, the development and the commitment of the new funding that we've given in terms of port development underlines, again, building a more resilient facility, which not only withstands the hurricanes, but is also able to take the kind of support and the vessels that are required to bring that assistance. So these are just two sort of major projects that we're undertaking with the government of Montserrat.
Good afternoon. Continuing on the assistance being given, I know James sought to get a more local or a more immediate assistance, in that there were some shortfalls or things that we were not ready yet. I don't know if the Premier would be able to. He may have addressed that already with you, and so that those things are already in place. Can I get a nod, Premier?
The nod, or I'll ask the Governor to respond as well.
Thank you
very
much.
There were certain provisions which were highlighted which were required. I know those have been addressed, but perhaps I can ask the Governor to respond.
Absolutely. Well, I think we've been making reasonably solid progress, and I would say thank you to the Foreign Office for its help for Montserrat with £350,000, or about $500,000 worth of more immediate and sort of light personal kit for a hurricane, so things like jackets and torches, that sort of equipment. We have discussed here in the recent NDPRAC meeting the issue of a digger derrick, which I think we've been clear on, all of us, is a significant risk to us here. If we were hit by a hurricane and a large number of our pylons and cables were pulled down by the wind, there is an issue as to how quickly that can be put back up and running. And the Minister has asked us to look in a strategic way at how we can solve that. And Foreign Office colleagues are working with the DMCA here on how best to address that. We haven't yet got the solution, so we shouldn't pretend we have. That is a significant gap we need to address.
I did not introduce myself, Lord Ahmed. I'm Bennett Roach from the Montserrat Reporter.
Sorry, I'm being distracted there. It's nothing to do with you. I think they're wondering where my passport was, which was always an important question to ask.
They can do an early booking.
Exactly. Otherwise, I'd be your guest for longer. But
that's there you go.
Over to you.
The governor here would recall that in our first meet, I put a challenge out to him to be more proactive, and I use the word more, maybe that's not why I shouldn't even say more, but rather be proactive, because over the last 6 years or so, we haven't had any kind of assistance in terms of the building up of civil society. And I think somewhere along the line, it was lost that the governor really needs to be protecting the people of Montserrat from those people, from the evils of those people, the politicians. I'm just kidding about that, of course.
You know you're addressing one as well.
But indeed, on, indeed, please. I should remember that, Mr.
Absolutely.
Minister. Yes, and I'm hoping, because I have noticed and so on from research that FCO does lean on DFID, but they have the responsibilities of carrying out all the civil society programs that DFID supports. And I'm really hoping that we can have a sit down and talk to FCO more directly and in a better way, and that we can get some better results. But I think civil society in Montserrat has been ignored for far too long. Unfortunately, we had these DFID people coming in as our governors, and so they concentrated on DFID things, and I don't know how we've progressed from that. But I would like to know if I can get that the governor can have your support and your commitment to assist us in these areas.
Well, thank you for that question. First of all, you know, in terms of Her Majesty's government, whether it's DFID or it's the Foreign Office or anyone else, you know, we very much act with one voice. I think our DFID teams, when you look around the work they do, the port here is a DFID-funded project. You know, that's an enabling project, which is actually ensuring that the long-term resilience, as I said to an earlier question, but the long-term progress and prosperity of a nation can be developed. DFID do some incredible and phenomenal work around the world. You know, we're proud of our colleagues in DFID. But I would also say to you, this is a single government approach. Myself and Lord Bates, who's the minister responsible for the overseas territories, work hand in glove. It's not a DFID think this and the Foreign Office think this. We do, I assure you, talk to each other. Not only do we talk to each other, we coordinate. Very effectively, and you smile wryly, but I can't account for history. I'm telling you how it is now, and once you know me well enough, you'll know that when I say it, I mean it. Now, in terms of what currently you've talked about civil society, you'll find me one of the strongest promoters, advocates for civil society. Indeed, in the meeting we've just had now, and I, Premier and the Governor are witness to it, one of the questions I asked in building resilience, in building the spirit of the response to hurricanes. I know this country of Montserrat is a country of deep faith. It's a country where religion matters, faith matters. Faith matters to me, so I understand the sheer humanity which prevails with people of faith. We need to ensure that compassion, that humanity is really brought together to the table, and civil society and all aspects of it, charitable groups, faith groups, need to be brought together as a normal part of the functioning of society, not just when hurricanes hit, but in terms of how society evolves. So if you're asking for my endorsement, I can assure you the governor doesn't need my blessing. The blessings come from up above, but my endorsement is very much there. Civil society are part and parcel of what defines Montserrat, and I've worked very well with the Premier here. And actually, he's been, I can assure you, a passionate advocate. And if you seek protection, well, the governor's there as the shield from the British government. But from this man on both my left and right, they're very much, I can assure you, when they're in my office in London, they are passionately making the case for Montserrat in terms of its progress, prosperity, but most importantly, its people.
Lord Ahmad, I know that time is against us, but there's the whole concern surrounding beneficial ownership, and there's been a lot of concern here as well as to where we are going. And I know personally that you are not in favor of the legislation that was enacted. Just give us your feel and the concerns that have been raised, not only here in the other overseas territories.
First of all, I'd say it's not just me personally who wasn't in favour. Her Majesty's government wasn't in favour. The Prime Minister wasn't in favour. And that's been underlined in phone calls that directly Mrs. May has undertaken with all the leaders of the overseas territories. Just in a nutshell, this legislation was introduced in the House of Lords. There was an amendment proposed for public registers, which was opposed very vociferously by myself on the point of principle, because of the positive nature of engagement with our overseas territories, the efforts the overseas territories had made. Indeed, they were ahead of the curve. And I totally buy into the principle of level playing fields. It was regrettable that when this particular piece of legislation went to the House of Commons, the opposition, together with certain members of our own governing party, chose not to support it. And that resulted in the figures against the government's defense not adding up. That meant that the amendment, the Hodge-Mitchell amendment, passed. When it came back to the House of Lords, it was very clear that the House of Commons, even if the House of Lords overturned it, would overturn it again. So the view was taken very much in the House of Commons to accept it. The question is, how do we move forward? As you may know, during this particular visit to the Caribbean, one of the primary areas, territories which has been affected is the Cayman Islands. You know, I don't hide away, I take it on the chin. And it was important that I reached out to the territories very early on, went to the territories and spoke directly to the industry, which I did so. I spoke directly to the financial services industry. What is required according to the legislation is if by 2020 any overseas territory does not have a public register of beneficial ownership, we will invoke, we are required as a government to invoke an order in council. The message I would leave everyone across the overseas territories family is that we are working very collaboratively, and we will work in a very cooperative fashion to both mitigate the risks and ensure that as we move forward on that piece of legislation, it's done without in any way hindering the positive progress that we've seen across the overseas territories family. And it's a message which was received very well in the Cayman Islands, and I hope that will be replicated here in Montserrat, and we will be addressing any particular concerns that have arisen from it. For example, there are issues of constitutional concern that have been raised by various territories and leaders. And we've said that the 2012 white paper will continue to be the basis on which we believe the relationship will progress. However, if any territory has proposals for reviewing elements of the constitutional relationship, please put that forward. And indeed, in the next JMC, the Joint Ministerial Council, which is being held in a couple of weeks' time, it is a key element of the agenda. So I hope that addresses your concerns directly.